Jesus loves you and wants to heal you. Evangelism, Book 4, written by Zacharias Tanee Fomum, narrated by Gerald Zimmerman. Preface. This book is for you. The Lord Jesus loves you and wants to heal you. God wants you to be healed and to remain in perfect health. Your diseases are the works of Satan. This book is not written to attack the modern practice of medicine. We thank God for modern medicine and all that it is doing to relieve pain. However, without the touch of God, medicine cannot heal. God is the healer. Jesus is the healer. He can work through modern medicine, and he can work without medicine. He is not limited. He is God. You can turn to him and be healed of your disease, and when doctors tell you that your case is hopeless, God remains your hope. Turn to him and receive your miracle from him. You may want me to stand with you in prayer and fasting for your healing. I will gladly do so. Please listen carefully to this audiobook and act on its message. When you have received your healing, write and share it with me by using ZTFbooks@cmfionline.org so that we may praise the Lord who has healed you. God bless you abundantly. Yours sincerely, Dr. Zacharias Tanee Fomum, Yaoundé, Cameroon. Chapter 1. Jesus is healing people today. Healed of sterility. I was born in the western province of parents who were nominal Christians, Catholic and Protestant, but at the same time very deeply rooted in ancestral customs and traditions, which included several cults and sacrifices offered to the skulls of the ancestors. Their faith in their traditions was so strong that they had to part just after I was born, not because they could no longer get along well together, but rather because the customs of the village required it. Thus, I had to live successively with my mother and guardians, and only knew my father after the age of 15. If there is something for which I shall ever be grateful, it is certainly the personal experience of salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ, who intervened in my life and changed its course on the 15th of March, 1978, when I was but a wreck. My intention, therefore, in the following lines is to present to the world at large, as an homage to my glorious deliverer, the sincere testimony of my life. My concern will be to present, firstly, the man I was before 15th of March, 1978. Apparently having a bright future, but in reality empty, disgusted with life that had nothing to offer me except its increasing bitterness and hopelessness. And secondly, the brand new man I have become since then, thanks to the infinite love of the one who is now my Lord and to whom I owe all loyalty, Jesus Christ. All along, I will insist on one aspect which, up to that day, had contributed a great deal in ruining my life, although I thought I was bringing more taste to it. I mean the sexual aspect. In fact, I had my first sexual experience right in my early childhood, long before the age of 9. Since then, I was haunted by sexual and immoral thoughts, in which I found myself having sexual intercourse with women, and even animals. The loose and shameless life of some men and women that I knew in that delicate period of my life only intensified in me that burning desire for sex. The numerous social taboos in this domain that was exclusively reserved for adults only sharpened my appetite and curiosity, especially as I had experienced some pleasure at my first attempt. Very favorable circumstances led me in 1961, while I was still in class 4, to have my second sexual experience. In the long run, the consequences of that sentimental adventure became rather critical for me. As a matter of fact, during my venture, I caught what, 7 years later, proved to be one of the most dreadful diseases possible, syphilis. Being as young as I was at that time, despite some ailments that followed a few months later, I could not suspect anything serious at all. It was only 3 years after I had been contaminated that I started feeling some acute pains in my genitals. This happened in class 7. Suspecting what the sickness could be, for we had just had in class a brief session on venereal diseases, I went to the school's medical center in Yaoundé. After consultation, the doctor sent me to the venereal disease center at Elig Asano, still in Yaoundé. Since I did not know the so-called center, I went to Mesa Dispensary instead. There, the nurses, after having read my hospital card and known what my problem was, instead of showing me how to get to the right place, far from helping me in my distress, they rather had a good time laughing at me. I was terribly shocked, confused, and full of shame. So I preferred to go back home, keeping my sickness to myself. Nobody knew about it, neither my friends nor my guardians, less still my parents who were so far away from me. In the meantime, the pain subsided for a few years, but unfortunately, I did not know that the sickness was causing more serious damages in my body. In 1968, that is 7 years after the contagion, while I was in Form 4 in Lycée General Leclerc in Yaoundé, the pain started again, more acute than ever, accompanied by a serious infection of my sex organs. Since, in the meantime, I had discovered by chance the said venereal disease center, I went there straight away as I could no longer stand the intense pain. Without any delay, the treatment started. It was very long and costly. Right from the first blood test, it was discovered that that vicious disease had gone right into my blood. From 1968 to 1973, I went from doctor to doctor and from one town to another for treatment. In my desperate pursuit of good health that I needed at any cost, even though I was penniless and without any backing, I went one day to a private clinic. Once again, the indiscretion of the nurse at the reception came as a very heavy blow to me. It left me more downcast than ever before. But my situation was such that there was no more turning back. I was ready to accept any shame in order to gain my healing. Therefore, in spite of their mockery, I persevered and was finally led to meet the doctor himself. The doctor, probably wanting to sympathize with me, ended up making my psychological condition worse than what it had been up to that time. Faced with the file of hospital cards that I had brought and seeing the considerable amount of treatment that I had already undergone without any improvement, he remained speechless for some time. Then suddenly I heard these few words, which for a long time became like a death sentence over me. "With all this," he said, "I hope that you are not thinking of getting married one day." From this statement, so much could be deduced concerning my health and my future. I did not see the point of asking him what he meant, for I had understood everything. As a matter of fact, he had only said what I had been dreading for quite some time, the fear of failing in my marriage, that is, of being sterile. But then I was in the upper sixth form, and the tragedy is that during the same year my father, who knew nothing about the problems I was facing, asked me if I was not going to get married after the final exam at the end of the school year. You might imagine that my poor health had suppressed in me the appetite for sex. Far from it. My sickness had certainly made me shy and full of fear whenever I was in front of the female sex, but the truth is that I had grown up and the sexual desire was getting more and more devastating in me, especially as the new literature that we started studying in high school was encouraging me in this way of immorality. French authors like Ronsard, Lamartine, Baudelaire soon became models to follow. Some of their poems, like Mignon and Loloc, have remained engraved in my memory. How could I resist the temptation when even the school, which is supposed to be a social and state institution, was encouraging me to enjoy myself fully, to enjoy my youth, to pick up the roses of life, as one of those writers says, before they fade away, since very soon I would grow old and die like the roses, and that would be the end of everything? How could I resist after listening to all the stories of the love adventures of my friends, which only increased in me an insatiable appetite for sex? If, because of my handicap, I could not run after beautiful girls who were the tender objects of my dreams, I could nevertheless reach the same final satisfaction through a less risky and less costly way. Thus, I indulged in masturbation and the pursuit of prostitutes and, by this way, kept spreading the syphilis I was harboring in my body and exposing my body at the same time to other diseases. August 1973 marked the apparent end of the treatment. A glimmer of hope seemed to dawn in my life, but I realized very soon that the sickness had left some side effects. Rheumatism, threat of impotence, and infertility. Nevertheless, after my course at École Normale Supérieure of Yaoundé, I entered the teaching career in 1975, my sentimental conquest extending into a new domain, the girls I taught. In 1977, I got married with the hope of settling down with a woman and leading a quiet and peaceful life. But alas, I quickly discovered...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.